and you don't have to log into a computer to do that. A new one that's a pretty big one, Einstein Recommendation Builder. So this brings a lot of AI-driven personalized recommendations to customers by matching records from one Salesforce object to another. If you guys have this on, it gives you a lot of great insights into your customers, what recommendations you should make while talking to them. For example, recommend the best product for an account. Tell Einstein throughout this process which Salesforce objects to learn from, so you can customize this in your settings and put your Einstein recommendation to work in the next best action strategy. Recommendation Builder supports all custom objects and most standard objects. So be sure to review the release highlights to see which objects it applies to. As we're going along, guys, if you're joining on as well, just want to remind just some Zoom etiquette. Just if you're on, go on mute, please. Other than that, if you have any questions, chuck them in the chat and I'll get to them as soon as I can. Another thing is on the summary page, you can dive into each object to create segments, exclude fields, and specify which records are examples of positive and negative interactions with your business, which is, from my point of view, pretty powerful moving forward. I think AI moving forward is a big thing, and it doesn't surprise me that Salesforce is building something such as Recommendation Builder, which gives you great insights into your customer and helps you sell and support your customers better. Dynamic Actions is now available for accounts, leads, opportunities, and cases. So Dynamic Actions also becomes GA for mobile for custom objects with this release. Dynamic Actions for account, case, contact, lead, and opportunity, and now GA for desktop. Dynamic Actions for all other standard objects are beta for desktop. So if you're not familiar with this, Dynamic Actions allows you on a lightning page layout to show and hide actions given certain criteria. You may want actions to only appear on a specific status of an opportunity or a specific record type of account or something else. And you can use those rules and conditions to show and hide those accordingly. This gives you a bit more flexibility from a user experience point of view, and also an engagement with your users. You now have the ability to do more with opportunity products. So this gives your sales team more flexibility to track information on opportunity product records. So for example, a rep wants to track two delivery locations in a related list for an opportunity product record. Now you can create an object relationship and page layout to make it happen. Previously, you couldn't do this. There was a lot of limitations. And I know for a fact that this is a common theme that a lot of businesses face. You know, they wanted to customize it a lot more, whereas now you have the ability to do so. I could see a lot of people in the chat loving Dynamic Actions, which is great. Yeah, Dynamic Actions are awesome. So, it's good to see that as well come in. Now, the next one, and this one is a big one, and you guys should all be as happy as I am for this one, and that is manual sharing is now available in Lightning Experience. Before, it was in Classic. It was always there, that share button, and it was a long-awaited transition of functionality from Classic to Lightning. This is one thing I've seen countless times where people have been asking for it, and also a thing that I've personally wanted for a long time to come into Lightning. So you can now manually share records between users and groups. So big hooray for this one here. Multi-add fields to reports. This now allows you to simplify and make it a lot faster and efficient, the creation of reports. So you can multi-select fields and drag them across to add them. So easy way to do that. If you have a Windows PC or a laptop, you press Control and click the fields that you want and then drag them across. If you've got Mac, I believe it's Command, click as well. And if you wanted to multi-select remove fields, you can do that as well. That's another cool feature. I think with building reports, it's a lot harder, you know, if you're going through trying to find each field, dragging each field across accordingly, takes a lot longer. Now you get the ability to do it in bulk. Some additional highlights before we move on to the highlights from flows. You can customize your default no reply address for email notifications. This is a big one. Currently there's just a default, you know, that no reply at salesforce.com. Before that, the spring 21 update, certain email notifications automatically just send from that no reply at salesforce.com. When you send case notifications from system address is on. Now you can choose which email address your org uses as the default from address for certain case related notifications. This is great for enhancing the customer experience as well as your internal org experience when your own users are seeing these emails. So rather than saying no reply at salesforce.com, you could say, for example, Sam Ramon, community group. All right. Power up recently viewed lists with customizable actions. So a long outstanding idea for the ability to have actions that are on the search layout of an object appear on the recently viewed list view. So there was a bit of a limitation before where you couldn't see those actions. You could see it on every other list view, whether it's a custom one you made or a standard out of the box. But the recently viewed list view didn't have this available to it until now. So that's a cool one to have a look into, play around with. You can customize field mappings for contact and event sync. That's a good new feature there as well. Add Zoom meeting links to events created using insert availability. So now that it is the day and age of Zoom meetings, I don't know how many Zoom meetings I have in a week, but it's a lot more than I used to when I first started. And it's a lot more than last year, right? So I think you guys all have increased the amount of Zoom meetings. And in saying that, I'm sure people in the sales world or the service world using Salesforce would have a lot of Zoom meetings as well. It gives you the ability now to create events and also generate that Zoom meeting link at the same time, making life a whole bunch easier for your users. Customize field mappings for contact and event sync. And I can see I've duplicated that point now. So we can just ignore that last version because I've gone ahead and duplicated that point there. So far, so good. And the next slide, we're looking at Salesforce Flow update. So Salesforce Flows, the first thing here is a naming change. You see that I've called it Salesforce Flows. It was previously called Lightning Flow. It is now being changed to be named Salesforce Flow. You can now refer to prior values of records updated. So I'm going to show you guys an example of that in a flow. An example use case, we'll go through that very shortly. But what you can do prior to the record triggered event, you can refer to those prior values of the record in your flow. It's quite handy. Some massive debug enhancements that came through. So debug directly on the canvas. You can support schedule triggered flows. It updated tests in error emails, ability to show query limits, easier failed flow debug, and accurate information added. Some other points to add is no more scrolling through a long flow error email to figure out what went wrong during the run. Now you can simply click a link in the error email to open Flow Builder and see the failed flow interviews path on the canvas. The detailed error information appears next to the canvas. Debug logs now record the total amount of CPU time consumed by a particular flow or process in the flow interview finished limit usage log line, which is great to know. You can now use automatically stored custom property editors. Previously, you were limited to using values that were manually assigned to the flow variables. And you can send surveys to gather participant feedback at various intervals using a flow. So target specific participants and send reminders to complete the survey and verify which participants to invite again. Use the action element in the flow builder to add an action for a survey. Send a survey to leads, contacts, and members of your Salesforce org. Invitations can be unique and unauthenticated for specific recipients. So you got that flexibility around it in terms of the surveys. You can access one other aspect. And the one other thing that I like that's part of Flow Spring 21 release, and that is build multi-column screens. And that's come into a beta now. This gives you a lot more flexibility around your screens. I've already built one flow. That was an example for one of the previous community group talks I did. If we have some time today, I might be able to pull that up for you guys. That uses this as well. It's a multi-column screen. Allows you to split up your screen flow into different columns, making it a lot easier, and also just formatting it a lot nicely. So the column will create a visually appealing and effective layout without touching a single line of code. The multi-column screen layout is responsive, so columns stack vertically to fit on mobile phones. This feature, which is now beta, includes changes since the pilot release. The section component now supports conditional visibility multi-column screens. Also benefit from improved styling for screen components, which is a separate generally available feature. So that's my Spring 21 highlights in a nutshell. And now we're going to go into the goodies, I would say, which is some flows and some examples of flows. So bear with me while I change my screens and let's get cracking into flows. Sheba, so far, is there any questions that you want me to go through, or we're all good so far?
Andrew, somebody just asked about, they want to know more about dynamic actions. Mm-hmm. So is there something that you can tell more about it or demo it, or you would like to, how would you like to
take it? I haven't set dynamic actions up yet, but I can walk through it if we have some time and showing you guys what it would look like. It's fairly straightforward. Dynamic actions, like I mentioned, you just add conditions on your Lightning page to just show and hide actions accordingly. So common use cases for it, I would suggest, is let's say, for example, you have opportunity process and you only expect your users to provide a quote at the qualification stage, let's call it. And you wouldn't want the create quote button to appear on the opportunity before that. So if it's on any other stage, let's say it's still prospecting or it's new, you wouldn't want that button to appear. So you can hide that based on the status value, and you'd set the status value as the visibility for it. That's one common use case I would say, which is showing and hiding buttons based on opportunity status. Cool. All right, I'm gonna get cracking into this. So I've created three flows for you guys today. The first one, I'm going to go through the use case we have for this first one, and it's demonstrating the record's prior value is, let's say a record is changed. If it is, we want to create a audit record. So a prerequisite for this, I've created a custom object called opportunity audit, and we're going to be populating that custom object during this process. Now, I know a lot of you may be thinking, and it's a very obvious thing, which is why aren't we using field history? Well, you can use field history, but when you go to use field history, you have some limitations. Right? You have limitations of how many fields you can track, as well as what level of detail you can track. It's preset. So in this one in particular, you're able to customize everything. So if I wanted more fields in my custom object, I can add more fields. So to start off, this is a record triggered flow, and I'm setting this when a record is updated. I don't want it when a record is created, because for obvious reasons, when it's created, there is no change to the values. And we want this after the record is saved. This is a lot easier to use after the record is saved, whereas before record save, I tend to use before record save for when I'm using a flow that's triggered and only should occur and update the record itself, not updating related records. I tend to use after record save when you're updating related records, creating related records and stuff like that. So the first thing is our trigger. I've set the opportunity, and I only want to do this for all opportunities where they're currently open. So So what I've done is I've used the standard field is closed, which is a checkbox, and I've set it to is closed equals false. Now this is a global constant value, which you'll have access to. So for any checkbox, when you go to add a value here in the resource section, it will have either global constant false or global constant true. And these are ones that you can use. So false is saying that it's unchecked. And my options down the bottom here is when to run the flow. So to update the records, we want to run the flow every time a record is updated and meets the condition requirements. In some cases, not in this one in particular, but in some cases you would want a flow to run only once. So only once when it meets those conditions. So example is I did a flow recently where it's marked as closed one, the opportunity. So whenever an opportunity is marked as closed one, you don't want that to run again. So you'd set that to only when a record is updated to meet the condition requirements, because it'd only be marked closed one once. You don't want that to run again when the record's updated. All right, so going on to here, first thing we want to do is check if this has been updated. So what we're going to do is we're going to have a decision element. And the decision elements are, I personally like, are very powerful in flows. Decision elements can add a complexity to your flow and adding different paths and different outcomes to your flow as well. This decision element is going to check multiple parts of it. So the first thing is checking, it has the product of interest field changed, because this is the field I'm checking to audit. What we're going to check is the record value. So this one's the value of the record we've updated. Does that currently equal the prior value of the record? So see here, we're now using that new value, which is available as part of the Spring 21 release, which is the prior value of that opportunity. So if my product of interest previously doesn't equal its current value, we want it to trigger. And also the record next step equals the prior value. Now, the reason I've got equals is because I have different paths where I want to update and create that audit record based on these fields. So this is only indicating the first outcome, the product of interest has changed, the next step has not, and will take us down that first path. The second path is indicating the product of interest has changed and the next step has changed. So where the product of interest current value, which we're looking at here, which is everything in record is current value. That's an easy way to identify. Everything that's record prior value or record prior is the previous value for that record. And what I mean by these is if I was to click there and I'll delete that for a minute, record is down here. You go down and it is the record that's used to create this flow and the prior value of that record before the event. All right, so if I go here, I can grab my, just type in product of interest there. Go ahead and add that field in there. It's quite good with, in terms of, if you're not familiar with flows and conditioning around flows, flows are really good, not just and conditionings. You can have all conditionings, and you can also have custom logic now, which is a newer thing, not from Spring 21. I believe it was back in Winter 20 custom logic came in, or the release before Winter 20. So it may have been in Autumn 20 as well. This allows you to do a combination of and ors. Similar to if you're familiar with how to do filtering and custom logic in a report, you can do the same thing here, you know, one and two or three and four. And finally, we need to have a default outcome. So where none of the conditions have been met, he'll go down the no path. Important thing to note with decision trees, it is evaluated in order of the outcomes you have. So it will evaluate this first path, then it will move on to the second path. It won't evaluate all at the same time and see where the record goes. So it'll work its way down, all the way down to the default outcome, which is the one down here. So make sure you put them in order of how you want them to execute. In most cases, if I was to do this again, I would rearrange these two and just do yes and next step change yes. So looking at this, we have three paths. Now, one thing to note when you're looking at my screen, I'm using the auto layout feature, which is still in beta, but I find it a lot handier because one, it's a lot easier formatted. I'm very OCD-like with my flows and I want them formatted. And before this feature, I used to click and drag things and get them all in one line, making sure they're perfect. But now it will do that for me. And also, it's a lot easier when it comes to adding resources and everything else and adding elements in. So I don't have to drag it from the left-hand side anymore from the board. You just click that little plus and it'll add it for me. So our first path was that path where the product of interest changed, but the next step didn't. So we're looking to this one. We're going to create a record. And what we're going to do is we're creating that opportunity audit record. So how many of these records do we want to create? One of them. We don't want multiples, otherwise we'll get duplicates. And we want us to use separate resources and literal values. Reason being is we haven't created a record collection. If you're not familiar with a record collection, record collections are a resource, which as the name suggests, it stores a collection of records in it. We haven't created that during this flow. We haven't created any collection variables at all. So we'll just use one, separate resources and literal values. I've set the object that I want to do. And again, this is a custom object I've created. So you'll need to create this beforehand. And we're going to go down and map our fields accordingly. So I've checked the field name of my opportunity audit object that I've created. And this is where the flexibility comes in, right? I was talking about at the beginning, difference between this and field history. You can add any fields you want to this opportunity order object. You can add comments, you can add pick lists, give you a bit more in-depth understanding of that actual field change itself rather than what there is now. So the first bit is the field name, and I've set that to product of interest because that's the field that's been changed. The new value, you can see here, I've referenced the record product of interest. Remember, it's very important to note now that we have the prior value options, record is the current value post update. Prior value is, as the name suggests, the prior value before the update. Opportunity, and I've set it as the ID of the record. I could use the prior ID because we know Salesforce IDs don't change. So it doesn't matter which one I use, it will work. The prior value, I'm using the record prior and product of interest field value. So this is making sure I'm getting both values there. Triggered by, and I'll set that to the user's ID, and that will be the user that triggered the flow, right? So you, with this one, to access that, we'll go to here, user, and you grab that variable there. So there are global variables in flow if you're not familiar, and this will have the ID of the user that triggered the flow, making it a lot easier to identify who is triggering the flow. And I can use that in that triggered by field, which is a lookup to the user. And finally, triggered date time. And this is set by the flow current date time, making sure it is correct. So you don't have to do put any guesswork into it, choosing what the date time is or anything like that. You're able to use a flow variable that sets the current date and time. And yes, one thing to note, these are all the API names. So these are all the API names of the field. These are pulled in. You don't have to type these, which is the best part. You just select it from here, what's available, right? So if I get rid of this, for example, and I click in here, it shows me what fields haven't been mapped so far. I click new value. All right, and I can map multiple fields more than once. This here on the left is the API names. On the right, if it's a pick list or a text field, you can set those values. They're the label values. If it's a pick list, then you can, it will give you the options of the pick list right here. So it will show you them and you can choose from them manually, which is even better. You don't have to remember them anymore. All right, moving on to our second outcome. And this is where product of interest change and next step changes. So we've got that same first opportunity audit create records. Again, doing the exact same thing that I just showed you. And now we've got a second opportunity audit, create records. So we're going to do one per field. You create an opportunity audit record per field that has changed. And this one here, again, we're doing one record. Use separate resources and literal values. We map to the opportunity audit field. Opportunity audit record. And field name, we're going to set that to next step this time rather than product of interest. You go new value, again, record new next step. Opportunity, got the record opportunity ID. Again, this doesn't matter which one you pull, if it's record or record prior. Prior value, record prior. Triggered by the user ID. And triggered date time is current date time. Fairly simple on that. Then we go down to our no. Now, I set this with a decision within a decision, if you look at this as such. And the reason why is when we go to that no outcome, we want to see if so far we've checked that product of interest has changed and we've checked that product of interest and next step change. Now we want to check that next step change. So where product of interest didn't change, but next step did change. We're going to set that condition here. So the record next step does not equal the record prior next step, which means a change has occurred there. And I don't have to add an additional condition saying that product of interest does not equal record prior product of interest, because in our previous decision, we've already checked that to get to this point. So we wouldn't have to do that yourself when you go into these decisions. Now, when I go into the first one, the yes path is creating that same thing, the opportunity audit for the next step. So I've got all those fields mapped again. Otherwise, if we go down no, and then again, the next step hasn't changed. So nothing has changed for that of the fields that we're looking at least, then it will exit the flow. Nothing will happen. Is there any questions on this particular flow? While you guys are thinking of some questions for this flow, let me get up a record and show you how it works. Shiva, is there any questions so far?
I think there was just a question about that next step and the product of interest. It's not a variable, it's just a value. So,
yeah. So in this bit here, in the create records bit where I'm writing it here, that's just a value I've typed in. It's not a variable. It's not stored anywhere. All I've done is hard coded that value. So I've typed in product of interest, and you're allowed to do that when it comes to text fields or number fields or even date times. You don't always have to use a variable in your flow.
Yeah, great instruction, Andrew. So much, a lot of clarifications.
That's all right, all good. I'll go to this record here, and what we're going to do is we're going to see the details of this record, and you can see on the right hand side if I've got it added to, no, I don't have it added to my page layout. So it'd be good if I had it added to my page layout. So what you're gonna see is next step there. And I'm gonna quickly update my page layout as well. Make sure I have that related object there for me. But bear with me, guys. I just a bit of technical difficulties, missing a page, an item from a page layout. But having a look at it, you guys haven't changed the page layout before. If you wanted to know how to do it easy from a lightning, I went from essentially the record itself, the setup button, and edit page. There's a little quick, handy way to do that for you. In this, the related list will show you your opportunity layouts that you have that you can then click on and edit accordingly. So I'm going to edit that one and leave this one here. And I'm going to quickly add my related lists. There we go. Opportunity audit is my custom object. And I'm going to do a quick save. Yes. Beautiful. So we should see now, if I refresh my page at the top here, the opportunity audit. Perfect. So that's there. And what we're going to do now is, you can see it's not in a closed state, so this will work. And we're going to set it, next step is call customer. And let's see, product of interest. We're going to add two product of interest. Demand tools, GridBuddy. These are just two examples I used from my org because these are two products that I know Validity sell, right? So if I was using the Validity example to create this. They sell demand tools and GridBuddy cloud. So you click save. And once I click save, required field missing prior value. Ooh. Looks like I have an error here. So looks like I'm missing a required field, prior value and date time modified. So that could lead me to believe that one of my mappings is incorrect. So we look here, we've got prior value here, which is good. Maps that, product of interest. Date time modified, triggered date time. Ooh, it's very interesting. We'll add that in and we'll add that field as well, previous value. So it looks like it's duplicated some fields, which I did not intend to duplicate some fields. So just bear with me guys. So I experienced a bit of technical difficulties, but it was working when I tested this earlier. But obviously some fields have been duplicated and you can't set them. So what you do with that record and that error, and this goes back to debugging, it's a bit obvious what's missing. So I'm missing two fields that are required, previous value, date, time modified. So I have to go back, make sure I map them. So I'll look into, if I'm looking at my flow, I can see here I haven't mapped those two fields. And that I would say is one of the dangers of doing separate resources and literal values. You don't know when you've missed required fields until you get to actually triggering it, right? You don't know when you've missed any particular fields in all. And you can end up like me on a call with everybody. And when you need it to work the most, it doesn't work, right? But yes, I can assure you this has worked in the past. But yeah, apologies for that one.
I see previous value there.
Yeah, I have to map it.
It's actually a
duplicate field somehow. I don't know how this happened, but I've attended to duplicate the field. But what I'm going to do is I'll map it for you guys. So record, we actually don't want the record one. We want to go down to record prior. And we grab this one was the product of interest. We grab the record prior, product of interest value, and date time modified is also the flow we type in. And it's very easy to use this. Instead of clicking, I'll just type flow, click enter, and I'll just start typing. It'll highlight current date time. I'll press down, press enter, and it'll fill it out for me. Right? You don't have to remember all of that. Done. And right here, we'll do it here as well. So date time modified. I'm gonna grab that flow variable again, which is current date time. And we add previous value, which is record prior. And this one is next step. Beautiful. And now we've made these changes. Click save as, and we're gonna save it as a new version. We don't need to do a new flow. I'll click save. And we want to activate that new version. So fingers crossed, this time it actually works. So I'm going to refresh my page. And we're going to go again. So this time, hopefully everything goes according to plan for customer. Now, what you can add as a complexity to, prior value missing, previous value. What did I do now? Ah, I know what's happened. So the previous value was blank. So what's happening is it's a required field and it's setting itself as blank. So this is where you got to be careful with required fields and using this option as well. So now you would have to add in some conditions around it to make sure that it's not blank. So make sure that the previous value I would add it in here is not blank into my next step. So this is, it's actually a good thing as well when this error is occurring. So it gives you an insight into to what's happening. All right, so if I wanted to, I put in, where is it? Record prior, next step, and we'll do is not equal to, and you can do empty string, and that's a global value as well. So it's not empty. We don't want it to be empty. And then you save it, and that'll be your conditioning as well. So you guys have witnessed firsthand how I would go for and debug a flow and when doing some basic debug. So apologies again that it wasn't working when I went to execute.
Hey, Andrew, but it's great learning, you know, like doing demos like this off the cuff is so hard for everyone, but you are actually showing us the whole cycle of it. That's great.
Yeah, I can tell you, I've been demoing flows for the last 4 weeks at different Salesforce community groups, and this is the first one by chance that has failed for me on a demo. So, yeah, it's
hats off to you. You've been giving so much knowledge and, you know, like instruction to everyone. It's you really appreciate it.
Yeah, I like look, the way I like to say it is everyone has their own way of doing debugging, right? I know that I know how things work inside the org I'm managing. I understand how things work, and I know where to look where certain errors are occurring, right? What I usually start off with is where the error message is pointing to. Sometimes, in most cases, the error message is very straightforward, right? In this case, it's telling me I'm missing some required fields. And I know for a fact when I was testing this, what condition I wanted to get to. I knew that I wanted to get to this condition here. So I don't need to look any further than that condition there. So if you were testing this and it's a controlled test, you know what condition this gets to, that's perfect. Let's say you had 20 different conditions, right, going across here. And this is in a live environment and one of your users are reporting this error. It's very important to capture as much information as possible from your users. So it's also, it's hard, I know, to get all that information, but it's good to train your users to say, right, if you get an issue, I need to know what you're trying to do, what fields you changed, where, what was it before? What was it before? Most likely, most users don't remember. Right? But if they remember what fields they changed, what they were trying to achieve, and what was the record, it's very easy for you to debug now, right? You take that record, you can duplicate it in the sandbox, or you can even mimic that user and ghost log in as the user on that record, try change those fields, see what happens. Work your way backwards is my best tip. And yes, Peter, it's a Saturday bug for sure. For me, it's a Sunday bug, I would say. But yeah, thank you all for sticking through that debugging. I'm going to move on to something else now. If you guys have any other questions about flow debugging or just debugging in general, let's chuck them in the chat and we'll flow with it. And let's say I plan to debug it. All right, we'll go with that for today. Going on to our next flow. And this is a simple one. I would say probably one of the simplest ones I've done. And that is a birthday scheduled triggered flow. So to send a birthday email to contact records. So what you'd do for this one, I only want this to trigger at a certain time every day. Now, the reason being is you want it to evaluate a lot of records in the process. So you don't want to see any performance issues to your users. So you want this as a scheduled triggered flow, not as a record trigger flow or anything like that. Also, there is no guarantee that a record will be updated, a contact record will be updated when the person's birthday is happening. So a record triggered flow in this case won't work because if I have a contact, their birthday is today, but none of my users touch that record, you'll never get the happy birthday email triggering. So scheduled trigger flow is always the best for these sorts of things. I've set it to start on a certain date, time, and the frequency daily. So I've already tested this once and I'll bring up the email later, what it looks like. So First thing is the decision, right? Or sorry, I should say the entry criteria first. And that is birth date is not null. So is null, and we set it to that global constant false. So we're making sure that birth date field is populated. So essentially, we're not going to evaluate any records that have a blank. If users have not captured that information, if you forgotten to put it in or whatever it may be, we don't want to waste time trying to capture those records and processing them through. Our decision is checking that birthday month is equal to today month and birthday day is equal to today day. Now, what you notice, these aren't the fields you have on a contact. What I've done is created four resources that are type formula. And what these are doing is the first one, getting the day of that birth date field, right? And that is our birthday day resource. Our birthday month is getting the month of the birth date field on the contact. And today day is getting the flow current day value. And today month is the flow current date month. Now, the reason we have to do it like this, and we can't just go birthday to today, is because the birth date is actually, let's say for me, 1997. Today is 2021, right? It won't work. You got to add those two together. You go equals birth date equals flow current date time. Won't work. What I've seen a lot of in the past is before this happened, before, you know, flow had been advancing, a lot of people created a custom field where they would, in process builder, populate that with the next year's value. So they would say, right, 1997, and in 1998 is the next year's value, or 2021 is my next year birthday. My birthday is 16th of April. So I would say 2021 in that field. You no longer have to do that with these resources and the formula one, right? You can set and manipulate that data in your flow already beforehand. No additional fields. So you can dedicate your limits to fields to something else. All right. And also, it doesn't clutter the UI for a user. Recently, I've talked at a Validity hosted webinar, and we're talking about the importance of decluttering your user interface, right? And also making sure data is presentable and usable. It's not presentable when you have 100 different fields on an object. That's not easy to use, right? And in amongst that, you have your key fields that you want to identify as a customer on your contact record. Of those 100, I would say max maybe 10 fields are what your key customer fields are. What I mean by key customer fields, first name, last name, email address, phone number. Doesn't have to be fax or second phone number or home phone or anything. Key fields. And as a business, a little tip for you guys when you're managing orgs, as a business, the first thing you want to do, or if you haven't done it yet, is identify what are your key customer fields. And that is to find those, discuss what is needed to contact your customer. We need the address. We need a phone number, and we need an email, and the first name and last name to address them. Things such as age, right, is a bonus. That's not a key field, I would say. Gender, again, bonus, right? That helps with content personalization when you're marketing to them and talking to them as well, but it's a bonus. It's not a key field that will impact business processes if you don't have it. In most cases, I would say. I always put that in at the end, most cases, because there is one or two cases around there that's an edge case where it needs it. So back to flows, and back to this flow in particular. We've set these formulas to get the month and the day of the birth date field and today, and compare the two. And that's where it comes into in this decision. So all I did in here is I just have to reference it. So in this one, I want to compare the month as the first one. I say birthday month equals today month. It already sets the values. And when it sets the values is at the beginning of the flow. So no matter what the first element is, by the time you reach that first element, these values have been set because of the formulas I have in place. Now, some instances, resources are set afterwards, later in flow. So if you use what's called an assignment element, you can set a resource later on and manually choose what it should be. If you have time, I can show you a pretty complex account management flow I made a while ago, and that's looking at those assignment values as well. So we've got yes, if they equal today, today's day, today's month. And one thing that caught me on using this formula is you got to set the data type to number, because those formulas, day and month, will return a number. They won't return a little text value. And I originally set the data type to text. And what you'll find is when you go to save it, it would have a debug item that it's an error, incorrect type for the variable. So this one, decimals can be zero, right? It doesn't have to be two places, as long as it's consistent. So it doesn't matter if I use two or zero, it still works for me because it's always going to be zero, zero, based on how this formula works. And I would say the one downside to resources is you can't change the data type once you've saved it. So I had to delete all my resources and create them again of the correct data type. But again, that's the life of debugging, right? You always find an error afterwards. You won't find it before, because in your mind beforehand, it works. In most cases, in my mind, it works beforehand. So we go into our action now. So to get the action, and again, I'm using the auto layout beta. I've added the little plus sign and clicked action. And I'll just show you all the different actions available. So you've got all five different categories. And this is fairly new, this feature here. You've got user-defined actions. So activate session-based permission sets, deactivate them. Group-based actions, add member, add record, new group. And they're quick actions. So task-based actions, change date, priority. These are all the actions you have available, right, in your org. We've also got some down here. So there's some on standard objects over there and some uncategorized ones as well. So create customer contact requests, approvals. Now I know that I would say that Salesforce is working to improve these actions, adding more to them as the releases go on. This is a pretty new element. So watch this space as you see more actions getting added and more flexibility to this element as well. Now what I've used here is the email one, and it's just send a simple email. So we've gone down here and that's our send simple email. And I've done this very, very basic. You can now do rich text formatted body for the email. I, for the sake of simplicity, didn't choose to do that. I chose just to use a body that's not really formatted. So what it says is, happy birthday. And then followed by that is the record first name. And if I go across, it says, hope you have an amazing day. Now, what I've done here is you can see I've used those variables, and that will allow me to do similar to what a merge field is in an email template. So if I highlight this and remove this for a second, I can add any variable I want that's within my flow, that's including the ones I created, the record values, into this. Now you can see here, there's no record prior value, which we were using before, because this is a scheduled flow. This won't have a prior value. Prior value only is applicable for record triggered flows. All right, so where an actual change has occurred. And I've used the first name. Now, if you remember syntax for these, you can add them in anywhere. Otherwise, if I've got text already in here and I go to press space, I can't choose from that dropdown anymore. So what I like to do is a little cheat to this one, is I copy this value into a little text file somewhere, or Word document, whatever it may be. And if I needed another one, like last name, so I've got my little text file open somewhere else on my second screen. Say I wanted my last name, And instead of me making a mistake in the naming of it, I'll go through, get that. I'll copy this now. I'll add this to my text file. And then I'll copy that whole value, put it in here. So now I have happy birthday, first name, and last name. So that's my little tip to you guys to make sure that you're pulling in the correct format and correct values. I've set the subject to happy birthday. Now this one, this next couple is important because you can make lots of easy mistakes here. This top one, email addresses in brackets collection, is a collection variable which has multiple email addresses in it. In this instance, we don't have that. We haven't set that. You wouldn't want to use this. In most cases, you wouldn't want to use this. All right, unless you have a collection variable, collection of records. So we're going to set it as the email of the record. It's really good. You can set it as the email from the record we're looking at within this flow. If you wanted to, you could have a rich text formatted body, and you could also set the sender address. Now, because this is a very basic org, we don't have form addresses set up or anything like that. But if you had org-wide addresses set up, you could reference that here, and you could also change the sender type. So that's my first flow of sending an email. That was one I made for you guys, and that was because of the anniversary. So I'm going to pull up what that email looks like. Wherever that email has gone, here we go. It looks like this. Ooh, where did my email go? And this is the email I got. All right. So this tells me here, the from address is just an automated process. It says, happy birthday, Andy. Hope you have an amazing day. All right, that was my contact that I triggered this off for the scheduled flow. And it's got happy birthday in the subject line. Now this external bit, just ignore. That's something my work email address appends to everything. But it's gone ahead and done, sent that email. And that's a very simple way to send an email to a customer. Nothing too complex. What I can show you is from our errors before that we were getting, I can show you the new format for emails, right? I got two emails for those errors. You saw we were debugging before. And they've cleaned up a lot of the naming. You can see it's a lot cleaner. So I could follow this through and see where the error occurred. I could see first my outcomes. No, it's evaluated, does not equal. And it shows me the records, product of interest values, these two, does not equal null. And which was the previous value, for customer does not equals null. All right, so it didn't equal that. So it went on to the next step. Yes, does not equal null. Then it will go to create. And as we'll see, previous value, and like we said, is null. It was setting that value to null. So whatever it has in the brackets is the value it's setting to, right, as you see here. And it's trying to set the previous value to null when it's a required field. So right then and there, I can see the issue. I can also see down the bottom here, nice and easy. So it occurred, and it'll tell you what happened. There's a lot more updates that came with Spring 21 in terms of the flow builder email. The format of it was a lot better. The naming of them has been cleaned up as well. I can see a question. Now, I actually don't know the answer to this one. Is there any option to attach email templates in email action? From what I've seen, and I did do some digging, you can't select an email template. I think there may be a way. Don't quote me on this one. It's still early in the morning for me, so my brain hasn't ticked over yet. But I think there may be a way to send an email from Flow with an email template. Unless I'm wrong.
I can add to that, actually. I tried it yesterday, and there's this new in the Spring 21, new rich text formatted body. Yep. That has been added. So what I did was in this, I added a GIF, like a happy birthday GIF, mm-hmm. and a message on top wishing you a happy birthday. And you can send it like that. So you can send a GIF image with the message through this. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's close to an email template, I think.
Yeah, and does it let you, with that, Sheba, the rich text formatted body, does that allow you to do like page breaks and go into new lines as well with that break code?
So I just formatted the text and centered it. I did not try page break, but I'm sure because it has the HTML format. Perfect. But there's a way to grab the image too. It is, you have to first upload it in the files and copy the image address and then paste it. So, yeah. So that, you know, person who is viewing the email that reaches them can view mm-hmm. the image.
Okay. Yeah, perfect then. So that would be perfect. You know, if you wanted to format that a lot easier, a lot nicer, you chuck in that HTML rich text.
I think I have a point. Maybe in rich text, like where you can write the HTML code, so then the page break might be possible, like because there are tags for HTML where you can do that. So I think it's possible.
Yeah, great point. Great point there. And thank you for chiming in. And I see there's a question. I wonder how the merge fields in the template look in there. So Andy is my merge field. That was my contact first name. So that was the value that came through. So for you guys, just forgot to point out that Andy value wasn't hard coded. I sent that from the scheduled flow with first name. So that's that first name there. You just pull in the value. All righty. One more flow. And if we have time, because my Zoom controls are getting in the way. If we have time, we're going to go through another one at the end. But this particular one is our first one here. So we're going to do another record trigger flow. Now, I tend to find the most popular types of flows are record triggered flows. And you probably see that in also the way I demo flows. I always tend to lean more towards the record triggered flows because that's always the most popular ones. Because you have options around create, delete, record update as well. So it gives you a lot of flexibility around record trigger flows. The delete aspect, which came in the last release, was pretty good, right? Well, a lot more than pretty good. But the ability to trigger a automated process on delete action is amazing. All right. So this one, we're going to do something different here. We're going to do where a record is created or updated and after the record is saved. And our use case here is an opportunity record is created or updated and meets this condition. So remember before I talked about only meeting this condition where it only meets the condition once we want it to work. We don't want it to work every time it meets the condition. So where the amount is greater than $5,000. And that 5,000 value is the value pulled from the amount field regardless of the currency. So if I have multi-currency set up in my org, and let's say I've got 5,000 Australian dollars on one opportunity, 5,000 US on another opportunity, we'll just check the value itself. It won't check the converted values, right? And I only want this to work once because what I'm doing in this is I'm creating a whole bunch of tasks and assigning a team member and also sending an email. So I don't want all of that to happen more than once during an opportunity process. So we're going down and our first action is, of course, sending an email. We're going to send an email. Hi, record owner, an opportunity you own has exceeded $5,000 and will require extra attention to convert. That's what my body is going to be. My subject line is large opportunity alert. The email address is the record owner email because that's who we're sending this to. And that's where I use the record owner.name to get their name. So if I'm the user that triggered this flow, it'll say, hi, Andrew Fragias. If it was Sheba, it would say, hi, Sheba, right? Pretty straightforward with this. We talked about a lot of the email action before. Now, I also, for these bigger deals as a company, we want a lot more care and attention by our sales team. So to speed things up for them, boost their productivity, we're going to automatically create two tasks and assign a manager to the opportunity team. So what we're going to do in that first one, we're going to do a create records element. And this is going to create one. Again, use separate values and separate resources, literal values on the task object. Set a description. I've hard coded this, so I've typed this in. This isn't a variable. And this says, ensure you capture the pain points of the customer so that you can align them with our product offerings. Also capture the buying process and decision makers. So this is giving, when my sales team sees this, gives them a bit of guidance around this deal, right? And they need to make sure that they complete this discovery analysis task. I've set the owner as the owner of the opportunity which triggered this flow. Set the field, the priority field, to high. Status not started. And the subject is discovery analysis. What ID? There are two fields in a task that are important, and same with an event. And that is the who ID and the what ID. Who ID is a physical person. So an object that relates to a physical person. In this case, Salesforce, its contacts, leads are common ones, right? What ID is some sort of process that it's related to. Account, and that is a business account. If it was a person account, it'll be under who ID. If you have opportunities, cases, that's all under what ID. And that, again, I use the ID of the opportunity that we get this flow. That's my first task created. At the same time, we want to create a demonstration task as well. So make sure to remind our salespeople to do a demo. And it's gone ahead and done that as well. So this one, demonstrate the product that best fits the pain points of the customer. So get a bit of guidance for our customers. Set the owner ID of the task to the record owner ID. Priority high, status not started. Now these ones I talked about before, pick lists. Priority is a pick list. And you can see here, it gives you the values that are available. So I don't have to type them, make a mistake, go to launch my flow, error, right? Make it easier for you guys, right? Always, when building a flow, I like to think and I like to say, do the bare minimum. And what I mean by do the bare minimum doesn't mean your flow elements are bare minimum. What I mean by that is don't type in items all the way through where you don't have to. So here, I don't have to make a mistake, just click high. No mistake, no typos, nothing. All right, no issue with our flow later on. Subject, I've typed that in. All right, you can also have, because subject is a special field on task. All right, is one, I think, I'm pretty sure it's the only field where it is a text field and a pick list. And to be honest, I didn't know that until about 6 months ago. And a lot of people don't know this. You can actually edit the subject field on task to add more pick list values, but it still maintains as a text field. And that is why I can get away with typing in demonstration. So little tip and fun fact for you guys. And finally, I set the what ID. Now, lastly, we've added our two tasks, send an email. We want to add a manager because this is a bigger deal for our company. We want a bit more support on this opportunity. So we add the manager to the opportunity team. So our salesperson doesn't have to do that anymore. We can automatically add this to the opportunity team. So we select that object, access level. I've clicked the read write option. Again, pick list value, bare minimum. Don't want to type things in, I don't have to. Opportunity ID, I map that. Team member role, again, I've chosen the pick list. Option sales manager. Now, where I got the user ID from depends on how your org is set up. A lot of orgs use this. A lot of orgs also don't use this. And that is the manager ID field, the manager lookup on the user object. There is a lookup on the user object that can be populated with the manager, right, user record. And you have to have this updated for this to work. You have to have this in practice for the way I've done it to work. Now, if you have another field somewhere else to identify who's the manager, you can. I know some businesses use territories, use role hierarchies as well to find out who's part of the teams. You can be using territories and role hierarchies and stuff like that. there are other means to getting this. Or you could even go further and go into one of my favorite things to do to make your life easier, and that is create a custom metadata type record that will store these values, who's manager, right? You can reference that within your flow, custom metadata. So essentially like a decision table that you can look up. That's what you can use metadata for. Is there any questions on this flow?
We
got you.
Can someone bring the socks for me?
Okay.
Hadi, let's open button.
Please open your mics and ask the question if you have any.
Andrew, this is Risha. Hope you guys can hear me.
Yeah, we can hear.
I don't have any question on this particular flow that you gave here. However, when I tried it to create a related.
Risha, we can hear you barely. So if you can speak up into the mic.
No, we can't hear you, sorry.
So, Andrew, I had one question.
Yeah.
Is it possible, like you said, you can't change the data type to text, right, later. But what if you turn the formula into text, say, date, month? So that formula itself, you turn it into text?
Yeah.
How does
you can. So whatever the output of the formula is needs to match the data type you have with that resource. So you're right. If I put a text around it, the reason is I wanted it to look a lot easier, right? A lot nicer and putting number. But yes, in some cases, when you use formulas, validation rules around pick lists, you see a lot of people because you can't use pick lists nested within certain formulas, you have to use the text part. Right, which will return the text value.
Okay.
If you guys, this is the last flow I wanted to show. If you guys had some time and you wanted me to show some more flows, I do have some more that I can show you. Pretty complex ones around account management, if you guys wanted to see it. It's up to you, Sheba.
So it's 11:17. I think maybe we can take 5 minute break.
Yeah, sure.
So we can take 5 minute bio break, and in the meanwhile, Anusha can sing a song on self-love. Anusha, let me share her the screen and introduce her.
Yeah, I'll start sharing.
So, you see my screen? This is Anusha. She's a California high school senior and a chamber singer, performer. So I welcome Anusha to please sing the song on self-love.
Hi. So I will be singing Just the Way You Are by Bruno Mars, because each and every one of you are perfect the way you are.
Stars look like they're not shining. Her hair falls perfectly without her trying. She's so beautiful, and I tell her every day. Yeah, I know, when I compliment her, she won't believe me. And it's so sad to think she don't see what I see. But every time she asks me, do I look okay, I say, when I see your face, there's not a thing that I would change. cause you're amazing just the way you are. And when you smile, the whole world stops and stares for a while, cause girl, you're amazing just the way you are. Yeah, her lips, her lips, I could kiss them all day if she let me. And her laugh, her laugh, she hates but I think it's so sexy. She's so beautiful and I tell her every day. Yeah, you know, you know, you know, I never ask you to change. If perfect's what you're searching for, then just stay the same. So don't even bother asking if you look okay. You know I'll say, when I see your face, there's not a thing that I would change, cause you're amazing just the way you are. And when you smile, the whole world stops and stares for a while, cause girl, you're amazing just the way you are. The way you are, the way you are. Just the way you are. When I see your face, there's not a thing that I would change, cause you're amazing just the way you are. And when you smile,
very nice, Anusha. Thank you. Thank you, Samira and Sarisha, for encouraging her. Anusha, you can stop sharing the screen. And so back to business, Andrew.
Yeah. Yeah, all good, all good. Yeah, so if you have some time, I can show you guys an example of a screen flow that would use that new multi-column section in it, if that's all right, if we have some time here.
Yeah, and there was one question. It was, we can get back to this after your flows demo, but I got this error when used triggered flow for a volume of around 80K records.
Mm-hmm.
This error occurred when Flow tried to create records, unable to lock row, unable to obtain exclusive access to this record.
Yeah, so firstly, I would start by asking if you have 80,000 records that are all triggering at once to trigger that record triggered flow, I'd suggest using a scheduled triggered flow. The reason being is you don't want to be using record trigger flow in the event that all of these records are getting updated at once, right? Then you cause issues. What that error is essentially saying is there are too many operations trying to lock that record at once in the short of it. And it's causing an error in Salesforce. And there's no Salesforce, when you update a record, it locks the record and then releases that lock like a normal database does post update. So that's some things you need to keep in mind when you're doing those flows. It also, as an admin, you need to be aware of all the flows happening, because if you're doing data uploads and you have a record triggered flow, then that can cause some havoc for you as an admin. Right? You cause all these issues when you, let's say I wanted to update 50,000 records and they all get triggered into a flow when I didn't really want them to go into a flow. So a good thing is to also have on your flows certain conditions around which users can trigger record trigger flows. So that's a great way to answer it. And looks like you've got it all sorted now. So good luck with your flow, Sarisha. Hopefully it works out for you. So yeah, Sheba, did you want me to show a quick screen flow?
Sure. I think everybody's excited to learn more and more.
Yeah. Well, I'm here all day, as the saying says. So if you guys, anything you guys want, any questions you want to ask me, doesn't have to be flow related, could be anything admin related, just feel free to chuck it in the chat, ask me a question, or if you wanted to unmute and we'll go through it. But for now, I'm going to go through this flow. And this is probably one of the complex flows I've built to date. Now this flow, the use case for it, and I'm not going to walk through all of it because if you have a look at it and I minimize it, it's quite big, right? But I'll talk through the use case of it. And the use case is essentially, I want the ability to launch a screen flow from a custom action, which you can do, and have the user have the ability to clone records and to decide which related records, given certain criteria, they can clone. So what I mean by that, and we'll see that when I open my screen flow, is I've given users the ability to clone account records and related objects, and I've given them checkboxes around certain types of records. So you could change it even further based on certain values and fields and filtering and stuff like that. But I've said essentially clone only open cases with the account, clone open and closed, or open opportunities or closed opportunities, my tasks and account teams. Now, if your org requires something else, you might have a custom object, a certain record type only, you can add that option in. The problem is the bit where this is important is all these decision splits. Right, so I have all these decision splits feeding into loops and assignment variables and everything else, but that will tell me what records to create. And I can see we've got a chat here, wherever my chat's gone. Yes, good point, Sheba. You can all save the chat by clicking the three dots next to it. So the first screen, yeah, Peter, I get that a lot. I'm sorry if my age and I gave my birth date before scares a lot of you. That is a common one that I get. Peter mentioned that. Is he the only one?
The youngest in the technology or what? And that is so knowledgeable, huh?
Oh, yeah. Look, the way I like to look at it is I'm only knowledgeable in this small area of technology, and technology is a massive area. Even Salesforce is a massive area. I don't know everything. I definitely don't know the world of development because I'm not a developer. And even from an admin side, you know, I only know what I know. There is more to it. And everybody adding their bits and pieces together, and that's what these community events are for, is what builds our knowledge. I'm grateful to have the opportunity to share with you guys. And thank you so much, Sheba, so far for this. So the thing you guys have been waiting for is seeing a screen with that multi-column. And that's what this looks like now, right? So before, just go all straight down underneath each other. To add it, it's very simple. It's just that section there, the beta. You click and drag it across and it will add to your canvas. Right, and I'll just delete that one there because I don't need it. Once you've got that, you have the ability to customize the width of it. So if I wanted to add more columns, it's easier as clicking that add more columns. And it will, by default, it will automatically evenly split it. And you can do a maximum of 4 columns, right? If I wanted to, let's say I'll delete that one and I'll delete the third one. If I wanted to, I'll make the first one a bit bigger, let's say, I can. Now you've got that option here to customize it, and it tells you which one is the exact path split.
And Andrew, right. This is from spring onwards, right? The spring.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's in all orgs as of now, because I believe Spring 21 has fully been rolled out as of now. And someone correct me if I'm wrong. So yeah, this one is pretty sick. And what I did with this, and are you sick? That's pretty cool, I should say. What I did with the second screen, so the first screen, they selected which related objects they wanted to clone. The second screen is when they're cloning the account. The use case where a user would clone an account is they might want to be creating a record that is very similar to your existing record. And in doing so, they want to change key fields, such as the name, customer type maybe, or the industry. Depends on your org what fields you add in here. All right. And some insights, and I'll give you some tips on ScreenForce. You can default the value to the actual value of the record that triggered this. Now, a handy trick for ScreenForce is when you have this and it's triggered by a custom action or anything like that, you don't have a way of capturing the ID of the record that triggered a screen flow. There is a workaround, and that is on a custom action triggered screen flow, you set a variable called record ID. Now this variable must be set and spelt and case sensitive the exact same way I have it here. Set it as a data type text, available for input, and record ID with a capital I only. And what this will do from that custom action is it will automatically store the ID of the record that triggered this screen flow. And a lot of people get stumped at this when it comes to building a screen flow. How do I store my record ID? This is a very important tip for that, because you'll then use that to get all the values in this get account records, right? I'm getting my account. And what I do is I set the ID equal to that record ID variable. And it will get all my fields and store those fields in a variable, which I can then reference on my screen here as default values. So when it comes up to cloning, it will have the default value of the account we cloned from, the type of it, the industry. It'll set those values for you. So handy tip, another one I'm giving out to you guys. Set a variable, and the easy way to do that in the beta version or any other way is create a new resource. And the type is variable. We call it the API name record, capital I, D, right? And then of type text, available for input. Now I've already used this API name, so I can't use it again, but that's the API name you need to use. So that's my quick showing of this. I talked before about an assignment variable. So I'll show you an example of how I use an assignment variable. And Shiva, after that, I'm going to chuck it back to you to finish up, because I can talk all day. I'm not sure if everyone wants to listen to me all day. So in this instance, we've got a collection of open cases, because one account can have multiple cases to it. Our get records is going ahead and using the condition of is closed equals false and account ID equals account ID from the account we did in the get records. What we've done here is we want to store all records and automatically store the fields. And this will automatically create what's called a record collection. Now in that record collection, we'll have record one, record two, record three, record four, right? And you can choose to sort it based on a particular field if you wanted to, or I've just not sorted it. In some use cases, it's important to sort it. In mine, it's not that important to sort it. So to use a record collection, you'll need a loop if you're going to create records. And what that loop will do is it will go through one by one each record and allow you to reference those details to create records from it. Because we're creating cases against this new account. So if you're following so far, we've created a new account, which we've cloned, and we're about to clone all the cases across. And that's allowed us to do that there. So we use the current item from our loop, and it'll go through and run that through. Now, before that, we're using here, if you'll notice, I've used all values from a record. The issue with that is record collections store the ID field. On the create records, you cannot have the ID field set because Salesforce doesn't have an ID. And now it will try to automatically map that if we leave it set. So what we're going to use the assignment for is to update our loop variable. So we say record one has ID 123456. And we're also saying record one has account ID 772, for example. Now we don't want it to link to that account anymore. And we need Salesforce to set the Salesforce ID of the record automatically. So what we're going to do is use an assignment variable to update the values in that. So the current items from loop, open cases, which is our loop, the field case ID, so in our first iteration will be that first open case, we'll set it to an empty string. Our current item from loop, account ID, we'll set it to the account ID of the cloned account we just created in the previous step. This is where assignment variables come into play. There is one of two real key ways you can use an assignment variable. If you use that record triggered flow and it is before save, that is where you use an assignment variable to update the record that triggered the flow rather than an update records element. Or in this case, you use it before a loop or before another action or element to update what's in the collection variable, update in a certain part of it, what's in a variable. So that was my quick insight into some more advanced flow things. Do you guys have any questions? Please feel free to open up the chat. Let me know your questions. And also, if you have any other questions, let us know. And Sheba, more people coming up with questions. I'm going to stop sharing and I'll hand it back to you.
So everybody, if you have any questions from Andrew, please open up your mic and you can directly ask him. I guess there are none.
It's a quiet bunch, I would say. Everyone loves their morning so far.
Yeah, does everyone want to open up their mics and cameras and we can do the networking and Ohana chat as well? Please, everyone, open up. Hi, Satya.
How are you?
How are you? Yeah, good to see you.
Hi, Peter. Think everybody fell asleep, I guess, right?
Oh, no.
I'm on the verge of falling asleep again.
hats off to Andrew. He woke up at 5 to, it says 5 o'clock, in the morning.
That's really great.
On a Sunday morning.
Yeah.
That's all right. It's nothing.
I asked him if he wanted to change the time, but he was comfortable with this time. I said, okay.
Daniel, typically you wake up early morning or only special for us over here?
I'll just say special for you. No. On the weekends, I don't wake up early morning. On the weekdays, I'm usually up around 5 a.m. I go to the gym at 5 a.m. in the morning and then gets me started for the day. I found that if, I'll say as a non-Salesforce tip I'll give everyone is if you go to the gym early before you go to work or anything, it gives you a lot fresher day. Even the days where I slept in and went to gym later in the day, I wasn't as fresh. I was still tired. So that's something I found working from home. That was a good tip.
Yeah, and Andrew is also a good cricketer.
Yeah, I've got cricket in a couple of hours as well. So Sunday cricket starts at about 2.5 hours.
Yeah. Well, that's our Indians. That's our sport, right? That's our That's yeah. where we hang out.
Great sport. I love cricket.
Yeah, in Australia too, cricket is really popular.
Yeah, cricket's really popular in Australia. Australia have pretty much like...
Oh yeah, we used three... to see a lot of Australia matches.
Yeah, there's three big sports in Australia. There's rugby league, or as we call it, NRL. Don't know what the American equivalent is of rugby league. It's nowhere near your NFL or anything like that, right? But
Giants, yeah.
Yeah, you've got rugby league, and then you've got cricket. That's one of our big sports as well. And I would say also rugby union is a big sport here as well. And that's another variation of rugby.
Peter, you must be having ice hockey there, right?
Well, I was going to say, we have all the, you know, we have rugby and cricket. It's just, you know, on ice.
Yeah, I mean, we were there in Toronto, you know, our son used to play ice hockey and curling and all that. Are you into all of that too?
I'll be transparent and say no. definitely. I used to play hockey.
Hockey, right?
I'm a big, I'm Croatian background, so we're all about football, or as Americans call it, soccer.
Yeah, so
that's really big, but we do have a really big Indian community. So there are, you know, there's a cricket league and some cricket games. I don't know much about it. I just know that
you guys have a 2020 league that's pretty popular as well. I remember watching some of the games most of the main nations have. A 2020 league, and 2020, for those of you that don't follow cricket that much, is the shortened format. There's three formats of it, which, as the name suggests, is 20 overs. Terminology, 20 overs is six balls per over, a bolt by the bowler, right? So the 2020 leagues are quite massive globally. There's the Indian Premier League, which is massive, the Caribbean Premier League. You see all the superstars around the globe joining these different 2020 leagues during the off season, and they put on a massive show, right? I would say probably the most famous one is the Indian Premier League. That's a big one. And if you guys have Netflix,